So good afternoon, everyone, and welcome again to this A to Z Oncology Orthopedic Webinars. I hand it over to Dr. Abhijit for further proceedings. Yeah. Over to you.
Thank you, sir. So good afternoon, all our friends. We would like to welcome you all for our fourth session of A to Z Orthopedic Oncology Webinar. And today we will be covering an important topic, that is role of CT scan. And we have two good faculties with us. Both are interventional radiologists and both are practicing in Ahmedabad. So today's topic is role of CT scan in orthopedic oncology, and basically we will be covering interventional radiology. So today we have two faculties with us. One is Dr. Rozil. So Dr. Rozil is interventional radiologist. He is practicing in Ahmedabad and he is very expert in all interventional procedures. He is doing significant number of RFAs, CT scan guided biopsies and angioembolization. And second faculty is Dr. Ketul Patak. He is also interventional radiologist. He is expert in the interventional radiology and is training in this important field. And he's attached as a visiting consultant at GCRF. And we have important collaborators with us, Dr. Ashok Sham sir and Neeraj Bijlani sir from Ortho TV. So today's topics will be RFA and role of angioembolization in orthopedic oncology. So this will be the first topic, and this will be covered by Dr. Rozil. So Dr. Rozil, you can share your screen so that we can start your PPT.
Okay. Good afternoon, all. Thank you, Dr. Abhijit sir, for giving me this opportunity. You'll have to stop screen sharing.
Okay. Stop screen sharing.
I'll be speaking about role of RFA and embolization in orthopedic oncology, how an intervention radiologist can help in the overall management of orthopedic onco patients. Starting with radio frequency ablation. What is radio frequency ablation? Basically, we heat the tissue. We heat the tumor tissue at 100 degrees Celsius for a few minutes. And 60 to 100 degrees is the ideal temperature. It causes vaporization, carbonization, or charring of the tumor tissue. And thus we treat them. So this is what happens. This is what a radio frequency ablation does. Basically, we cook the tissue. Advantages: it is minimally invasive, it has less morbidity, it has prolonged pain relief, it is safe. Sometimes we can combine it with the cementoplasty procedures also. Generally, it is done for under CT guidance. Indications: it is curative in osteoma, chondroblastoma, when pain score in case of malignant metastasis is 4 or more. Can also be done for sclerotic metastasis. And when the suitable or standard therapy for pain management has failed, this can be done. It is contraindicated in pregnancy, in pacemaker, and in patients with coagulopathy. Complications of bleeding, recurrence, residue, infection. So I will be stressing more on the how the procedure is done and how what are things which are required in the procedure. So what we do is identify the proper part, take the patient in CT scan, insert K wire into the lesion so that the path is created up to the lesion. Over a K wire, we insert this blue needle that is called the hard introducer. And through the introducer, we insert the RF ablation electrode. This is the RF ablation electrode. This is the connecting wire, and this is the RF generator. Thus, the electrode and generator are connected, and this generator, we can change the settings And generally, we give temperature of 90 to 100 degrees Celsius for 8 minutes. So this is how it works. And we have pads. We keep it on the patient's abdomen, and thus it they are called the grounding pads. This is the RF ablation electrode. It has multiple prongs. It can be opened up in patients with chondroblastoma or lytic metastasis. Whereas in osteosteoma, the prongs don't get opened because it is a small lesion. We try to go by the short and the safest route. Coming for the examples, this is a 17-year-old male, operated once for upper tibial osteosteoma. Now had repeat symptoms of pain after 6 months. CT MRI showed two lesions. We can see two lesions. This is the first lesion with the lytic component here. This is the second lesion. Both the lesions are seen with lytic or a lucent component with intralucent sclerotic nidus. Did a biopsy. It was osteosteoma. This is the sclerotic component and this is the lytic component of the lesion. Again, you can see the lytic component here. So there are two lesions with a long segment. So RF electrode can burn at a diameter of 7 to 10 mm. For lesions which are longer, we need to ablate, we need to over ablate, or we need to do multiple sessions at the same time. So that we can ablate properly, we can cover the entire part. These are our tracks by which we have ablated. This is the K wire or the electrode tracks. This is how they look on the CT scan after ablation. The lesion doesn't change in appearance, but however, you can see our tracks through which we have ablated. The appearance of the lesion, it changes after 3 to 6 months, not before. This is in short images. This is the first ablation. This is the second. This is the third. And this is the fourth. During the fourth ablation, this is a sagittal view. You can see all the previous tracks, first, second, third, and the fourth. So this is how we ablate, or we do a multiple session ablation for long nidus of osteosteoma. Another case, distal tibial osteosteoma. This is the CT images. We are trying, we have inserted first and local needle of spinal needle for seeing whether we are on the right track or not. This is the spinal needle to judge the angle. And then we have inserted a K wire. Sorry. It is going up to the, we are reaching slowly, slowly up to the nidus. And we have reached the nidus. This is after ablation. We can see the airfield track. Another case, upper tibial osteosteoma in the epiphysis. A 12-year-old female, knee pain, no movement disability. This is the insulator up to the tibial bone, and this is the electrode inside the bone into the nidus. So insulator is kept always up to the bone surface so that the skin muscle don't get burned. It has a proximal insulating tip. It doesn't transmit heat. Another case, osteosteoma mid femur. You're going straight. The vessels are laterally. The vessels are medially, and we have gone directly into the nidus. So this is the position of the electrode, just proximal, just superficial to the nidus, and this is through and through the nidus. Proximal femur osteosteoma. Here we have gone laterally. The vessels are medially. These are the femoral vessels and the bundle. And we have gone laterally direct into the nidus. This is a talar osteosteoma. You can see it is reaching the joint, very near the joint. This is the position of our introducer. This is the ankle and our electrode. This is the CT gantry. And this is the position of RF electrode into the nidus. And this is our introducer, as we have shown it here. And this is post-RFA needle track. This is radius intramedullary osteosteoma. This is osteosteoma in the medulla. This is RF ablation electrode. Electrode is in the nidus, and the introducer is up to the bone surface. This is post-ablation track. The loosened track is seen, showing us that we have done our procedure successfully. Coming to the spine osteosteomas. This was a middle-aged male with lower back pain. CT showed L4 lamina osteosteoma. This is our electrode tip in the nidus. It is away from the canal. So there is no need of injecting epidural air or any protective substance in the dura. Otherwise, sometimes we do inject 5% dextrose or air before the procedure to protect the nerve bundles. This is ablation. Again, L3 osteosteoma. You can see it is on the facet, inferior facet. Small nidus away from the nerve bundles. This is RF ablation electrode. And this is our introducer. For pain, metastatic RCC, large mets with soft tissue component at C5, pain score was high. This was FDG uptake showing large metastasis in the C5 vertebra. This was RF ablation electrode. You can see the prongs have opened up, so we can generate more heat and we can ablate more large surface area of the tissue. And this is post-ablation complete resolution of the uptake. So the tumor is dead, and thus the pain would be very less. Chondroblastoma, upper tibia, abutting the, as we know, it always abuts the joint surface. This is the MRI, hypointense on T1, hyper on T2. These are sagittal images. This is the axial image. RF ablation through the posterior root was done. These are the popliteal vessels. We have gone medially. And this is post ablation. Biopsy was done by someone from the anterior root before. And these are the prongs opened up completely. Patient was discharged on the next day and has pain relief since 6-7 years now. is another case, young male with metastatic alveolar cell sarcoma of pelvis, metastatic to thigh, tibia, lungs, liver. Pain score was high. And this is the lesions in the pelvis. He had severe pain in the at the knee joint level. This is a proximal tibia lytic lesion. So RF ablation was done and the cementoplasty was done in the same setting. Follow-up X-ray. This is an interesting case. 45-year-old male, well-nourished, history of body ache and progressive weakness, more pain in the right hip. Serum phosphorus was reduced. Radiograph showed a lesion in the right femoral head. And DOTATOC PET CT was done, which showed a small lesion. It was ultimately a tumor-induced osteomalacia. This is a small lesion in the femoral head. And RF ablation was done for that. This is the RF ablation electrode. Post-RFA, phosphate levels returned to normal. No weakness, normal activity. And we have this patient with follow-up since 5 years now. Okay, I've shown very good results. I will show also show a complication. This was a patient, 11-year-old male with right femoral head chondroblastoma. We did an RF ablation. This is the MRI. Hypointense on T1, hyper on T2 in the epiphysis, typical chondroblastoma. Large area involving the joint. Multiple sessions, it was a large lesion, around 3 cm. Multiple sessions was done of RF ablation. And this is the track after RF ablation. These are the prongs. 3 months after RFA, the head collapsed. Probably we had over ablated. That might be the reason of head collapsing. Fibromatosis, chronic right shoulder pain, 23-year-old male. Fibromatosis was anterior to scapula and posterior to the chest wall muscle. So difficult for surgery. And this is the lesion. This is the CT. This is the lesion on the left side. This is the RF electrode inserted under CT guidance. And we are ablating the entire area. So multiple overlapping ablations along the entire length of fibromatosis. This is to reduce the pain and for efficient pain relief. Sometimes RFA plus vertebroplasty is done for pain relief. So first we ablate the tissue, create a cavity. This is a transpedicular bilateral. We have gone inside the vertebra and this is the RF prongs. So this is to ablate the tissue. And then after ablation, you can see air foci inside the tumor tissue. This indicates adequate chairing, adequate ablation. And after that, cementoplasty or vertebroplasty to augment the vertebra. Another case, 16-year-old male, dorsal pain, mid-back pain, and then CT MR showed a small lesion in the D8 vertebra, just abutting the dura and the cord. Biopsy was done from the transpedicular root and it confirmed osteoid osteoma. But ablation was not done because we are afraid that we might damage the cord. So, but still, there are some people who can still do with epidural injection of air and 5% dextrose. But again, it carries a risk. Coming to the vascular part in orthopedic oncology, how intervention radiologist can help? What we do is we embolize the tumors, the bone tumors, the sacral tumors. We do preoperative embolization. How we do is we take a vascular access with the femoral artery. We go inside the tumor artery supplying the tumor. We inject embolic agent. So embolic agents are, these are the PVA particles, they're very small, fine particles coming from 100 micron to 1000 micron in size. They go up to the tumor tissue in the capillary levels, keeping the main arteries patent and cause tumor necrosis. So this helps before surgery the intraoperative bleed is less in cases of pelvic surgeries. We also have coils. These are the coils. It can occlude the major arteries, the major supplying branches, and thus causes necrosis of the tumor. This is glue. This is a schematic diagram. This is a catheter, and this is the small lesion. And these are small micron particles, PVA particles, 100 to 300 micron. That is going up to the tumor tissue. So it effectively, it can't occlude this major artery, but they occlude the tumor supplying branches. And so the tumor can't take vascularity from other sources. And thus there is good amount of necrosis, from 70 to 100% necrosis of the tumor because of embolization. We generally take femoral access with 5-French vascular sheath. We have multiple catheters. This is how our catheters are. This is the Cobra catheter, C2, the Siemens 1 catheter. These two are the catheters which we use more often. Sometimes we also use JB1 catheter. These are all pre-shaped catheters. We go inside the artery with this catheter. Then we take a micro catheter. This is a 2.7 French micro catheter. Through this microcatheter, we can go selectively in the tumor supplying branch, and these are the particles. It comes from 100 to 1000 PVA micron size. This is also, so basically we mix it with contrast and inject the suspension into the tumor supplying branch through the microcatheter. Young female, hemangioma, deep fold hemangioma with also epidural component. She had symptoms and difficulty in walking. Angiography was done. This is our catheter in the intercostal artery. And you can see the hypervascular blush in the hemangioma. These are all the vascular space. And this is the spinal artery. When we see the spinal artery for hemangioma embolization, we stop. We don't embolize. So for this patient, we did a direct injection of sclerosant in the hemangioma under CT guidance by inserting a 11 gauge needle transpedicularly. This patient had reduction in lower limb weakness and she was asymptomatic afterwards. Again, another case, D11 vertebral hemangioma planned for surgery. A preoperative embolization was done. This was a hypervascular blush from the D11 intercostal artery. Selective, and this is the spinal artery. You can see the typical U-shaped turn in the anterior spinal artery. So just the hypervascular blush was embolized, not the artery. This is pre-embolization, hypervascular blush. This is post-embolization. You can see the main artery is patent. We are just embolizing the blushes. The tumor blush is embolized with the PVA particles. Similarly, other arteries. This was a right side D11 pre and post-embolization. Young female, single large sacral metastasis from a known renal primary. Renal primary was operated a few months back, and the plan was to operate or remove the large sacral mets. This was from the internal iliac branch. This is the large hypervascular blush from the left sacral iliac lesion. And this is post-embolization. You can see all the normal branches, but no tumor blush. So this is the beauty of embolization. We super-selectively embolize or close the tumor arteries. Most common sacral GCT where we roll, you can't see the S2 to S5 vertebra. And you can see large soft tissue. This is the Foley's catheter. So patient has problems in passing urine and patient is in prone position and not able to walk. This is pre-embolization and post-embolization aortogram. You can see both internal iliac and both external iliac and common iliac and aorta. So this is a pelvic angiogram. The pre-embolization, you see a large central, the black color, it is a large central blush. Basically, tumor needs more blood than the normal tissue. So the contrast is going more in the tumor. This is after embolization of each and every tumor feeding vessel. You don't see a black hypervascular blush. These patients need multiple sessions every 2 months. This is pre, this is post, the tumor size is reduced. Another case is not the same case. Another case with less calcification, less ossification in the sacral tumor, and after embolization, they increase, they start to ossify. And this helps in relieving the symptoms. Right hip pain, 40-year-old male. Right iliac bone lesion, biopsy revealed GCT. This is the hypervascular blush, as I mentioned earlier. And this is post-embolization. So serial radiographs of GCT after embolization, they generally show calcification and ossification, and it helps in evaluating the effects of embolization. So when the tumor starts gets ossified, we stop, and also we see the symptoms. If there are no symptoms, then we stop embolizing. So generally 2 or 3 sessions are needed in cases of large lesions. GCT of humerus. This is the lytic lesion, proximal humerus, and biopsy proven GCT for preoperative embolization. This is our catheter in the distal subclavian artery. You can see hypervascular blush from these 2 or 3 vessels. After selectively cannulating and embolizing, there is no blush. And the rest of the arteries are patent. This is an ischial tuberosity GCT. This is the femoral head. This is the internal iliac artery. And this is the blush. You can see the black thing here is the tumor hypervascular blush. And this is post-embolization. This patient had complete necrosis and histopathic examination of specimen. This is a radial GCT. This is the ulna and this is the distal radius. Embolization was done. This is preoperative. This is postoperative. The radial artery is patent, but no branches are supplying the tumor. This is pre-op. You can see the hypervascular blush extreme. And this is post-op. Now, nothing is supplying the tumor. And all the branches to the fingers are patent. Just a small video. After spinal surgery, patient had recurrent bleeding from the dressing site. So from one of the lumbar branch, there is a small pseudoaneurysm here. This was embolized and bleeding stopped. Last, this is just a C2 vertebral biopsy. This is a bone biopsy needle inserted from the transoral root under general anesthesia. This is a sclerotic lesion in the right C2 transverse process. This was an FD. Similarly, another case, C2 lytic lesion, transoral biopsy, and this is GCT. Okay. I hope I have shown enough cases and quenched the thirst of how IR, what all procedures we can do, and we can ultimately help in the oral patient's management.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Rosal. It was nice lecture, and we had good orientation of what is RFA, because it's not that common procedure. It's not done by orthopedic surgeons. So we got good idea that what is radio frequency ablation, and secondly, what is angioembolization. So again, specialty of intervention radiologists. So bit uncommon topic to orthopedic surgeons. So thank you very much. We'd like you to be there with us for our discussion session. Now we'd like to invite Dr. Ketul. So Dr. Ketul is intervention radiologist, and he will be sharing his experience on what is role of CT guided biopsy and vertebroplasty. So important topics for diagnosis of bone tumors, that is CT guided biopsy. And secondly is vertebroplasty. So Dr. Ketul, you can share your screen and start your lecture.
Yes, sir. Okay, so good afternoon, everyone. Thank you, Abhijit sir, for giving me the opportunity. We'll be discussing about role of CT scan in orthopedic oncology, interventional radiology perspectives. We'll be mainly discussing about CT guided biopsies and vertebroplasties. So first we'll discuss about general tips and general what do you need to know before doing a biopsy. So obviously pre-biopsy imaging is very essential. If the patient has multiple lesions, then we should select the lesion which is most amenable to biopsy, allowing highest yield with lowest risk of complications. When the patient has multiple lesions, multiple bone lesions or lesions anywhere, we don't need to be worried about biopsy needle tract seeding of tumor cells, because the tumor is already stage 4 or metastatic, so we should not be worried about it. But when there is a solitary lesion and there are chances that this lesion can be malignant, then we should be very cautious about the route which we take for doing the biopsy, because it can very less chances, very rarely, but yes, it can the tumor the needle tract seeding of tumor cells can be seen at the later stage. When there is associated soft tissue component along with the bone tumor, we should take biopsy from that only, because that will give us a better yield. Same thing goes for the least mineralized portion of the bone tumor. If we take sample from there, then we'll get a better yield. So if we have a slightest confusion in our mind that this can be an infective etiology instead of a malignant etiology, we should take samples both in saline and formalin as well, and send the sample to bacteriologic examination as well. So as we discussed, choose the shortest path from skin to lesion while avoiding the neurovascular structures. What is adequate biopsy sample? This is a very important question. The sample that provides enough abnormal tissue for a pathologist to comfortably make a diagnosis. Here I have highlighted enough part of this definition, because if we do not take enough sample, then the report of pathologist will be like this, and which will be of no use for us. So we'll have to do the repeat biopsy and go through the pain of talking to the patient that why the biopsy came negative, etc., etc. So coming to the type of biopsy needles that we use, this is most frequently used Jamshedi bone biopsy needle. This needle has a stylet which is longer than the bone biopsy needle. It helps us in entering the bone and traversing the bone. After entering the bone, we remove this stylet and we take biopsy from the outer biopsy needle, which is over here. So the most important disadvantage with this needle is if we want to take multiple samples, then every time we need to insert the needle again and again, and in that process we lose the access. So we have to do the procedure again and again for 2 to 3 or 4 times. Okay, so during CT guided biopsies, this is the needle which we use. This is basically a multi-purpose needle, multi-purpose bone biopsy needle. It can be used for access. I mean, for RFA, it can be used. It can be used for taking biopsy. It can be used. It can also be used to inject cement in during the vertebroplasty. So this needle comprises of total four parts. This one is these two parts make mid outer biopsy needle. This is inner biopsy needle, and this is the obturator. So we insert the stilet inside this outer biopsy needle, and we reach the desired location under CT guidance. After that, we remove this needle, this stilet, and we insert this inner biopsy needle, and we take multiple cores. This inner biopsy needle has trephine tip, so that we can take multiple, we can take samples through the bone, even osteoblastic metastasis or very thick sclerotic bone very easily. So without losing the access, we can take biopsy from this needle, and this is the most commonly used needle in CT guided biopsy. Now coming to soft tissue biopsy needle, when the lesion is the most of the lesion or a part of a lesion is a soft tissue, then we use this needle. This needle takes 2 centimeter long course, as it can be seen in the picture, in the diagrammatic representation and in the photo as well. Now coming to the most advanced needle, which is powered bone biopsy needle. So this needle provides superior course than any other biopsy needles that we discussed. Here I'll be sharing a case, and I'll be sharing a video how we use this needle. So in this patient, this is a T2 star hyperintense area in the right iliac blade posteriorly. And we want to biopsy this using this powered bone biopsy needle. So this video was in this video we'll be discussing about that. And this video was shot 2 years back when I was doing my fellowship. So here we go with the video. First, needle placement is to be confirmed on CT scan. Yes, we are at a proper place. Then local anesthesia infiltration from cortex till the skin. This is Arrow uncontrolled bone biopsy system. The drill is supplied separately, and the bone biopsy components are supplied separately. So these are the parts. These are the parts of the component. This is the biopsy needle. These two are the obturators, and this is the plastic covering. This is the needle which will be using for taking a sample from bone. A good bold nick is needed. Biopsy needle placement is to be confirmed on CT scan. Yes, we are in good position to go ahead. Now, important thing that the drill is supplied separately and it is unsterile. So how to make this procedure sterile and hold the drill with your own hands, I mean operator's own hands. So they supply a plastic covering with that, so that the whole drill will be covered with this pouch, plastic covering, and the procedure will be sterile, and we don't need to touch anything else or outside the field of our work. Now the this drill is automatic, so we just need to use the drill and direct the needle towards where we want it to go, confirming that the needle is in correct position. Now we are trying to, we are puncturing the outer cortex of bone. You can see that there are 1 centimeter markings over the needle, incremental markings that will tell us how deep we are and how deep we need to go. Now as we have punctured the cortex, we can remove this stilet, which is pointed. And now this needle only will be used for taking core. Okay, stopping right there, checking whether our direction is correct or not. Going a bit deeper because the lesion is long. Okay, this is adequate. now the same way we introduce the needle, the same way we take it out. Now we are showing you how you remove the core from your needle. This is the obturator. Now we are showing how you remove the core from the needle using this obturator. Now I'm stopping right there. Yes, so this long core can be taken with a single entry, and this will be sufficient for diagnosis. We don't need to take any other core. So this is the most important advantage of this needle, and we can see the needle tract as well post biopsy. Now coming to some examples of CT guided biopsies. This patient was referred for biopsy of sacroiliac joint. Nothing fancy in that. We just insert our needle in the sacroiliac joint. This is the outer needle. We will remove the stillet and then insert the inner needle and take multiple cores from here. This patient had previous ABC, which was operated, and then she presented with a small lesion in his clavicle. So now we have to see that there is a bone which we need to traverse during the procedure. So we first enter here through the bone biopsy needle. We keep our bone biopsy needle over here. We remove the stillet and then introduce the inner biopsy needle. So like this, we can take our core, and this turned out to be recurrent ABC as well. Now, coming to this patient, middle-aged male with a lytic lesion, osteolytic lesion in the anterior acetabulum. Now, we have to plan this biopsy carefully, because we cannot go from here because it can injure the bladder. We cannot go anteriorly because the neurovascular structure, neurovascular bundle is lying over here. So we have to go from lateral portion of the thigh. So we entered like this from laterally. This was the lesion. So we kept our needle over here, outer needle, and then inserted the inner needle and took the whole core. This turned out to be tuberculosis. This discussion of this slide is important because we have not used bone biopsy needle in this. The soft tissue biopsy needle is enough to puncture and penetrate the bone, because the bone is already destroyed in this part, and up till this area there is tip of the needle, and after that we have opened the 2 centimeter core, 2 centimeter cutting edge of the needle. So we'll get 2 centimeter long cores, and this turned out to be tuberculosis as well. Now coming to hybrid technique. So sometimes we need to traverse the bone in order to reach a soft tissue. So here this patient had a lytic and a sclerotic vertebral body bone lesion. We went inside through the transpedicular route. We reached till here using the bone biopsy needle, which you can very well see. So till here we have reached using the bone biopsy needle, and after that we have removed the stillet and we have introduced the soft tissue needle. That was the beauty of this Cook osteocyte needle, that you do not need to lose your access. You can use another needle. You can also use the needle that is supplied with this bone biopsy needle as well. And this turned out to be plasmacytoma. Same example, when you need to break the cortex, or when you need to traverse through bone, you need to use a bone biopsy needle. And once you reach the soft tissue component, you open the soft tissue biopsy needle. So this long core will be taken. Now, this was a young male with a lesion in lower end of femur. So there is no way that we can enter this whole part using the soft tissue biopsy needle. So we introduce the bone biopsy needle till this portion, till the lesion. And after reaching this part, we have opened the soft tissue biopsy needle. So soft tissue biopsy needle provides very good cores through this bone biopsy needle. and this turned out to be chondroblastoma. This needle is multipurpose needle that we discussed. So using the same needle and using the same track, we inserted RFA electrode and ablated this chondroblastoma. You will be able to see prongs of the RFA probe that are opened in the chondroblastoma. So this needle is usually the workhorse of CT-guided bone biopsies. Now, coming to last case, this is not a bone biopsy, but in order to reach some difficult areas, you need to puncture the bone. So this patient presented with anterior mediastinal mass. These are the branches of aorta, and this is the arch of aorta over here. We can think of three. We could think of three paths that we can traverse the lung parenchyma and go here and do the biopsy, or we can go through the cartilage, or we can go through bone. So we chose the safest option that we traverse the sternum using the bone biopsy needle. We just kept our bone biopsy needle at the inner table of the sternum and then opened the soft tissue biopsy needle. This demarcation line is between aorta. This is the arch of aorta and this is soft tissue. So this turned out to be thymoma. So bone biopsy needles are very useful, and it's thoughtful use. Thoughtful use can bring you good results. Now coming to vertebral augmentation therapies, mainly there are three VATs: vertebroplasty, kyphoplasty, I mean balloon kyphoplasty, and vertebral implant devices. Indication of VATs is mainly painful osteolytic bone metastasis, multiple myeloma, vertebral compression fractures in osteoporotic patient, and vertebral osteonecrosis. Contraindications, obviously, in bleeding diathesis, without correcting the bleeding diathesis, we won't do any procedure. Active infection, you cannot do the procedure. Lesions with epidural extension are contraindicated. Why? Because if the lesion has epidural extension and if we inject the cement inside, then the cement can go epidurally and then it can increase or aggravate the cord compression. So that would be emergency, and you need to relieve the compression. You have to go for surgery. So you have to be very cautious during the vertebroplasty of lesions with epidural extension. We cannot do this in osteoblastic lesions. We cannot do vertebroplasty in technically non-feasible places where the that is vertebra plana, that when the vertebral height is less than 25% of the normal vertebra, then the cement will not spread properly and the results will not be good. So in vertebra plana, we should not do vertebroplasties. Now, which patients do we treat? So acute patients, acute VCF patients with visual analog pain score of more than 6, that are the ideal candidates for vertebral augmentation therapies. Coming to SINCE score, you orthopedic guys are better judge than us at this for SINCE score. When we will intervene is when the spine is potentially unstable, when the total of the points are 7 to 12. But when once it goes more than 12, then the surgical consultation is needed. So 12 is the differentiating point. When it is less than 12, we can do VATs, vertebral augmentation therapies. But once it goes beyond 12, then surgery is advised. Role of cement. Generally, we use PMMA cement. It helps us in stabilization of microfractures, provides mechanical support, it destroys the nerve endings, and it has possible anti-tumoral effect as well. These are the roots of vertebroplasty. These are the same roots that we can discuss for reaching the vertebral body for any CT-guided biopsy as well. This is the transpedicular route, which is which is the safest. We insert the needle posterolaterally from bilateral posterolateral aspects through the pedicle. This approach is parapedicular. We have to insert the needle through costovertebral joint and then go in the direction of vertebral body. And this is the posterolateral approach. Volume of cement used is the amount that is needed to fill approximately 50 to 70% of the residual volume of the compressed vertebra. Approximately 4 ml for thoracic and 8 ml for lumbar vertebra is the amount that we have to use. Now coming to some examples. This is the acute VCF, both MRI and CT. We introduced 11G bone biopsy needles posterolaterally through transpedicular approach and reach the vertebral body and introduce the and inject the cement. So this was the last, this was the final result. There is equal the proper distribution of cement in the vertebral body. Another case like this, in this case we did two vertebral bodies at a single point of time. So this one is the upper and this one is lower. This one is the upper compressed vertebra. So we introduced both the needles just like we do in the transpedicular access, and we inserted the cement. This was the lower one, same bilateral transpedicular access. In both the patients, the VAS scores on the before the procedure and after the procedures. Before the procedure, it was more than 6. In one patient, it was 7. In one patient, it was 6. And after the procedure, both the patients, after the procedure, after 2 days, the VAS scores reduced drastically. Now coming to, no procedure is without complications. Coming to complications, the most disastrous complication of vertebroplasty is a cement leak. Cement can leak in any direction. This is the transpedicular access. The cement can leak posteriorly in the epidural space. It can leak in the venous, paravertebral venous channels, and the leak can go in the paravertebral area as well. This, after doing the vertebroplasty, this is a discal leak. This is the cement is going into the venous channels, and this is the epidural space leak. Epidural space leak is the most disastrous complication because it can cause spinal cord compression, and acute intervention or acute surgery will be needed. If the cement spreads in the paravertebral area along the tract, then the patient will complain of pain, and it will generally be able to subside after 1 week or so with proper pain management. Venous channels, venous leaks are not that common, but if that occurs, usually no significant effect or impact on patient is seen. Sometimes this paravertebral veins, the cement from this paravertebral veins can go to pulmonary circulation and cause pulmonary embolism as well. Coming to examples, the cementoplasty was done here, and this is a paradiscal leak. Nothing to be worried about it. No symptoms. Patient did not complain of anything. In this patient, we can see cement in the vertebral body. This is a para. This is a venous channels leak. This is also venous channels leak. And here we are able to see a pulmonary embolism. But this is usually clinically very subtle. Patient does not have any complaints or any symptoms. This is the cement in the vertebral body post vertebroplasty. This is cement in the venous channel, and there is leak in the posterior in the epidural space as well. This can cause cord compression, and acute intervention may be necessary. This is also a pulmonary embolism post vertebroplasty. In case of cement leak, what do we do? So if we see, usually the vertebroplasty procedure is done in continuous fluoro, with good quality continuous fluoro. So if we see that there is a cement leak, then we stop the injection right there. We wait for 2 to 3 minutes. And usually the preferred way is to do with bilateral transpedicular access, that if there is leak from one access, we can inject a small amount of cement from another access, another needle, and then we check what's happening. That if there is leak continuously, then we stop right there and we abandon the procedure. But if there is redistribution of cement in other parts of vertebral body, then we continue with that and we finish the procedure with the other needle. This is balloon kyphoplasty. We inject a biopsy needle or a bone biopsy needle through the transpedicular access, and then we inflate a balloon inside, and then we insert the cement inside. There is no significant difference between the results of vertebroplasty and balloon kyphoplasty. but balloon kyphoplasty is costlier than vertebroplasty. These are the balloon insertion devices for vertebroplasty. These are available with Medtronic and very costly. Now with this, I'm ending my discussion, and this is for the salute to Corona warriors all over the country.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Ketul. It was a nice lecture, and we got very good idea. What is the role of CT-guided biopsy? It's very important that inaccessible sites like pelvis, sacrum, or like Dr. Rosil said, cervical spine. So we can't have access with our simple radiology methods. And CT-guided biopsy is very key in these rare sites or uncommon sites where access is not possible. And you nicely showed what is vertebroplasty. So it's important for all spine surgeons, orthopedic surgeons, and how it is performed. So we'll have few cases. So I'd like to have your both inputs for these cases. So I'll share my screen.
Okay, just a second.
Yeah.
Okay, I'll stop sharing.
So this is the first case. So it's a 22 years gentleman with pain in right thigh for 10 to 12 months duration. He had history of increased pain at night, and which was partially relieved or completely relieved by analgesics, and he had no swelling or deformity. So this is his X-ray, anteroposterior and lateral views. So Dr. Rosil, what are your thoughts on this X-ray? So what it shows to us, because X-ray is the key thing for our orthopedic surgeons. We first get an X-ray done, and then we take what is the differential diagnosis and what should be done for this patient.
Yeah, I think this is a right femur AP and lateral X-rays with periosteal reaction in the mid femur. It's probably, or I think there's a small lucent area in between. The periosteal reaction is solid. There is no lytic lesion. It's a benign lesion, and the differentials can be osteoma or an infection.
Yeah. So this is very important.
Osteomyelitis.
Yeah. So Dr. Rosil said very important to read the X-ray properly, that we can see that it's a solid periosteal reaction, no osteolytic lesion, intramedullary or anything else, no significant soft tissue component, and some lytic lesion is seen inside the nidus part. So that can be the nidus. So what he nicely elaborated, the differential diagnosis can be osteomyelitis. Yes, it can be osteomyelitis. Very important differential. It can be osteoid osteoma. It's less likely to be osteosarcoma, less likely to be giant cell tumor. So next investigation, we would like to do what treatment should be done for this patient. So can we directly jump for surgical treatment? So it's not a good idea. We should get the patient investigated. So this is very important. Just don't overlook the lesion. Get it investigated. So we'll ask for a few blood investigations. We may ask for MRI and CT scan. So which blood investigations are important? We'll ask a complete blood count, ESR, CRP, calcium and alkaline phosphate. So all these investigations are required. So if the bone infection is there, ESR and CRP will be raised and CBC will be raised. So these two things importantly rule out infection. So what is the next investigation we'll ask? It will be MRI for this patient. So for this current patient, all these investigations were normal and we had asked for a MRI. So is MRI required for diagnosis in this case? So it's important that we'll require a MRI for diagnosis. Just we can't do any treatment based on only a X-ray. So Dr. Ketul, this was the X-ray of the patient, and these are his MRI images. So this is a T1 image, and you can see a lesion in femur. So can you describe for all our orthopedic friends that what is T1, what is T2, and what you see in this?
Sir, the first image is T1 image, and second two images are fat suppressed TUR images. The T1 image shows a significant periosteal reaction, and the T2 shows nidus. That is second and third image show us T2 hyperintense nidus that is elongated and oval shape, and along with the marrow hyperintensity in the medullary part.
Yeah. So it's important that you should read the X-ray. What the radiologist says, that is important. But as an orthopedic surgeon, you should know what is basically T1, what is T2 and what are the findings. So that will be important for us. And these were the MRI images, second images. And this, you can elaborate on this image. So what you see in the first two images, you're able to appreciate what is going in your mind, that what's your differential diagnosis based on MRI. So any other investigation required for this patient, you will require a CT scan or you are happy with this only MRI?
Sir, this is okay. If the nidus is not visible properly, then we have to go for CT. But in this case, nidus is visible beautifully.
So any specific thing you require for CT scan? Any specific type of CT or fine cuts? What is teaches in orthopedic surgery that it should be 1 mm, 2 mm, what mm's? So fine cuts are required.
Pardon,
sir? Thin cuts.
Thin cuts are required. Thin cut CT scan.
Yes, yes.
So thin cut CT scans are required for this case. So CT scan will be helpful in this case, because if you are planning some treatment for this, then CT scan will be useful. So Dr. Ozil, this was a CT scan. So can you describe the CT scan for us?
Is the finding? So basically it's a lucent non-aggressive lesion in the cortex with thick periosteal, solid periosteal reaction and no soft tissue. No lysis of the bone. So it's just a lucent nidus and in the cortex with thick periosteal solid reaction. So it is an mid-femoral cortical osteoosteoma.
Yeah. So this was the images showing the nidus.
Yes.
And the periosteal reaction nicely seen here. And this was the images. The radiologist nicely described what was the distance from the cortex from the both sides. So it helped us to go for the diagnosis of osteoosteoma. So this was a 3D reconstruction performed by him. And so what we do we require biopsy in all the cases, or we are happy with the radiological diagnosis that it's osteoosteoma? So Dr. Ketul, you do biopsy in all cases or specific only few cases?
When there is suspicion, here we are sure that this is a osteoosteoma only, so that we do not need to do biopsy. But in cases when we are not sure, when the lesion is elongated, lesion is partly big in size, when there is confusion that this can be osteomyelitis as well, in that case we need to do biopsy. But in this case we do not.
Okay, so this is also important learning message, that osteoosteoma less likely requires biopsy. So your diagnosis is based on X-ray, MRI, CT scan and blood investigation. And rarely we require a biopsy if you are suspecting more chances of osteomyelitis. So what is the treatment for osteoosteoma? So we can manage it medically. So NSAIDs can be given, but this can't be given for long term because it may cause renal damage. So surgery, again, a good treatment options, but it's causing more morbidity as compared to what benefit it provides. And the nidus is very small in size. So the orthopedic surgeons in our audience who must have done surgery for osteoosteoma, they will regret that why it was done, because it's too small to locate and you remove a lot of normal bone while doing surgery. So best treatment options nowadays, universally all over the world at all centers, is RFA. And Dr. Rosil has nicely described RFA for us. So RFA is very important treatment option, and these are few references. So it's very useful technique, safe, it's alternative to surgery, very low complications, very low recurrence rate. But the issue with RFA is you require a very good interventional radiologist. So that are very less available all over the country, because less number of people are doing these. And second is the cost. So bit higher cost. So these are two only drawbacks, that you require a good interventional radiologist and the cost of this procedure. But it's excellent procedure. Both are interventional radiologists will agree with me that it's nice procedure, very less pain. It's daycare procedure. Patient can be discharged same day or next day. So it's very nice procedure.
Yeah.
So a second case. So Dr. Rosin, this is the X-ray you can describe for us. It's a 9 years boy, lesion in scapula, pain for 5 to 6 months and swelling for 3 to 4 months leakage. Sorry for the quality of the X-ray. It was taken around 5-6 years back by us.
Understood. So this is a AP view, right shoulder, anteroposterior view. And lytic lesion in the right scapula involving the body and the glenoid. The bone is very much thinned out. So it is a lytic expansile lesion. And there is no periosteal reaction. Probably rupture of cortex in the lateral aspect. So it is a conclusion would be, and it is an expansile aggressive lesion involving the right scapula. Yeah. And probable first would be malignancy, or second would be aneurysmal bone cyst or something like that. But it's an aggressive lesion.
Yes. So very nicely described by Dr. Rosin, that it's a expansile lytic lesion. Looks a bit aggressive. Nearly whole of the scapula is involved. So for a 9 years boy, it's a big lesion that whole scapula is involved. And you should proceed with proper steps that MRI should be performed and a biopsy should be performed. So the differential diagnosis on X-ray, it can be a simple bone cyst. It can be aneurysmal bone cyst. It can be osteosarcoma, telangiectatic osteosarcoma. Less likely it's DCT. It's very uncommon that it can be chondrosarcoma. So these were the MRI images. And you can help our audience that how you read the MRI, Dr. Rosin.
So first we check what is the sequence it is. So this is a coronal images, and the lesion, generally the inflammation or the pathology generally looks hyper intense on T2 and it is hypo intense on T1, and we compare it with the fat. So this is a T2 coronal images. There are multiple septations. It is well defined. The cortex is thinned out. And there are multiple septations, few internal locules and soft tissue. So I think it would be a aneurysmal bone cyst, most likely. Yeah. Or a second diagnosis would be GCT, but yeah, biopsy would be helpful.
So it's a 9 years boy. So more likely we will go for ABC as compared to GCT.
Yeah, yes.
So these were the T2 axial images. And we thought that fluid levels are not there clearly seen in this case. So they are seen commonly in aneurysmal bone cyst, telangiectatic osteosarcoma. So just fluid level, by seeing only this, we can't reach the diagnosis that it's an aneurysmal bone cyst. So Dr. Ketul, what can be the treatment options? The biopsy was done and it's an aneurysmal bone cyst. So we have three treatment options available here. So one is observation. So it's not that good idea. What is going in your mind that you'll go for surgery or you'll like to do some interventional procedure for this patient?
We can get access into the lesion and then insert the sclerosant. That will help.
Yeah.
That will help reducing the pain, and that will save the child from going through the surgery as well.
Yeah. So scapulectomy will be quite morbid procedure. So if you are removing the scapula of the child or any person, so he'll have no shoulder movement. The shoulder movement, which will be totally lost. So interventional radiology provides very important role here. So it can be CT guided or simple sure, X-ray guided, image guided. It can be done IITV guided. So we can use a sclerosant. So commonly used is Ascarol, polidoconol, which is used by a general surgeon friends for varicose veins, and curopsy. So curopsy will be aggressive biopsy and remove all the blood and everything. And it will give very good outcomes to these patients. So this is the method what we use. We use a three-way cannula and make a good foam. So we'll have a video of this, how this is done. And it's very cheaper injection. So costing 200-300 rupees and gives very good outcome. And good number of papers have been published by our Indian authors and foreign authors on this technique, that use of sclerosant and curopsy. So CT-guided curopsy and sclerosant was planned for this current case. And this was the lesion. And if we see this first X-ray, it was significantly osteolytic. And this is the X-ray after 4 months. So we can appreciate here, there is sclerosis in the lesion at yes. 4 months follow-up. So this was the X-ray at 12 months. So as compared to the previous X-ray, we again give one more injection. So two injections were given for this child. And this was the X-ray after 12 months. So it showed very good sclerosis at 12 months, and this is after 2 years. So it's very nicely sclerosed and had given very good outcomes to this child, and we didn't require any morbid surgery like scapulectomy, and this was the functional outcome. So this was not possible with any surgery, either curettage or scapulectomy, we could have not achieved full range of movement of the shoulder joint. So this is a paper published by Ames, Dr. Rastogi, and it's showing that percutaneous sclerotherapy, so in any method, either CT-guided, image-guided, it gives very good outcome, and it's very useful for inaccessible sites. So this was scapula, so a rare, uncommon site, and gave very good outcome. So again, this is X-ray showing. So Dr. Rosal, you can read the X-ray for us and MRI for all our friends, that what it shows to you.
Yeah. So this is an X-ray pelvis with both hip joints, AP view, and basically there is an expansion and lysis of the ischial tuberosity, and the posterior pubic process, and which corresponds to fluid blood level in the MRI. This is a T2 weighted axial MRI image. So it is typical aneurysmal bone cyst of the ischial tuberosity.
So Dr. Ketul, how will you proceed for the diagnosis? You will do X-ray guided biopsy or CT guided biopsy? What will be preferred here?
CT guided would be better.
CT guided will be better, yeah. So again, what Dr. Ketul described in his lecture, CT guided biopsy is very important here. X-ray guided will be very difficult. Open biopsy is not an option for this case. So CT guided biopsy is the best approach. So CT guided biopsy was done for this patient. It turned out to be a aneurysmal bone cyst. And sclerosant was given, again, CT guided, and it showed very good outcome for this patient. So second case, this was our published paper, again, showing a lesion, a different case, showing lesion in the superior pubic rami going into the acetabular area. And it was treated with 2 injections sclerosant, Velius girl, and it showed nice results. That again, same, use of CT-guided biopsy and CT-guided sclerosant induction. So use of intervention radiology. So this was our paper published in 2017. On this topic, percutaneous sclerotherapy, what we're talking about. So we'll share a small video of aneurysmal bone cyst and sclerosant technique. So here we have done image guided, X-ray guided, and so it was a talus lesion, and we are showing all the steps. So again, a lesion into the talus, radiographically it's a lytic lesion. MRI was done and biopsy was confirmed. It's aneurysmal bone cyst. So we are always doing 2-step procedure. So first we do biopsy, confirm the diagnosis. And second stage, we do curopsy. And what are the steps of curopsy? It's a aggressive curopsy. So small incision is taken. And G needle is inserted. Again, we check with the help of IITV or CT scan, which is an inaccessible site. So here we are introducing the G needle into the talus. Curopsy is done, so all septa are broken here. You can see aggressively it's done. So the needle is rotated and all the septa should be broken, so that only will give good role of sclerosant. So the sclerosant will not act. You aspirate all the material, so it can be around 50 to 100 ml blood is aspirated from these cavities, if it's small cavity. So all the material is again sent for histopathology second time. And this is how the curopsy is done, image guided. You can see the humerus lesion is there and the needle is just used to break all the septa here. And this is how the sclerosant is loaded. So depending on the size of the lesion, you can use 1 or 2 sclerosant injections. And we make foam of this. So this is again a useful method, commonly described in the varicose vein surgical procedures. So use a 3-way. So the volume of the injection is increased. So this is commonly used method by us. Use a 3-way and increase the volume of the foam. So less amount of injection is required. And this sclerosant injection is injected with optimal pressure and keep it for 1 to 2 minutes so that it will prevent the backflow of the injection. And then again put 1 to 2 ml normal saline into the cavity. So second case, again, same scapula case where sclerosis was given, a different case, 14 years boy. So this was the lesion, one injection, and this is after second injection. And this is the small scar, which is required for the biopsy. And this is the last case, fibula. So lesion, which was treated outside with curettage, and then we did curopsy and sclerosis injection. And this is a case of talus and metacarpal here. So the take-home message of today's session was that the role of radiological investigation, CT scan and MRI, are important for radiological diagnosis of osteoid osteoma, and guidelines should be prepared properly for minimal invasive treatments like vertebroplasty or sclerosis or RFA, which are very good important alternatives to surgery, and a multidisciplinary treatment is required. So we are taking help of our radiologist friends and intervention radiologists to treat these patients. So it's very important to have multidisciplinary approach. You should talk with the radiologist. What is his diagnosis? Talk with the pathologist. What is his diagnosis? And it will be always a team effort that you treat the patient very well. So I'll like to thank our speakers, Dr. Rosil and Dr. Ketul, for giving their important time on Sunday afternoon and helping us to get a good knowledge of what is interventional radiology. And I thank very much to both of them and Dr. Ashok Shyam sir for helping us to conduct this Ortho TV session. And so we'll try to have another session this month end, most probably, which will be based on MRI. So role of MRI in orthopedic oncology. So how to read a MRI, what is T1, what is T2, what is meaning of STIR, and what is its role in getting the diagnosis of these cases. So I'll like to thank everyone who have attended this session. So thank you very much. Yeah.
Thank you, Abhijit, sir.
Yeah, thanks.
Thank you.
Thanks, Dr. Rosil, and thanks.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, thank you very much. Yeah, Ashok, sir, we can conclude our session today.
Hi.
Yeah, thank you very much, sir.
So thanks very much, all of you. I think a lot of questions were answered, especially from the trainees and postgraduate point of view in looking at radiographs. And it will also have a lot of general orthopedic consultants in dealing with these kind of imagings. And all, of course, the solutions that you offered for treatment of these pathologies. So thanks again, everyone, on behalf of Ortho TV, and we look forward to the next episodes.
Yeah, thank you.
Thanks, Abhijit. Thanks, Rosil.
Thank you.
Thanks, Dr.
Yeah, thanks. Yeah, bye. Thank you, sir.